This is Seattle's so-called Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone, CHAZ for short. Several blocks of the city now taken over by protesters. After several days of violent clashes between police and the protesters, officers retreated from the area to de-escalate the tension, effectively abandoning their station. On Thursday, President Trump threatened to intervene, tweeting to Washington Governor Jay Inslee and Seattle Mayor Jenny Durkin to take back the city now, or he would. But protests have been calm and peaceful since the police left, and the mayor is pushing back.
That is more like a block party atmosphere. It's not an armed takeover. It's not a military junta.
You should know, leaving the precinct was not my decision.
Seattle's police chief publicly at odds with the decision to flee. Although not calling the mayor out by name, it's clear the two are not on the same page.
Ultimately, the city had other plans for the building and relented to severe public pressure. I'm angry about how this all came about.
Protesters say they won't be intimidated by threats and say they plan to stay as long as it takes to bring about change.
I'm not scared of Donald Trump, no, and I'm not scared of his police officers either. We're going to stay outside this building whether they come here or not. We're going to take this building over whether they're outside threatening us or not. We're not afraid of them.
Among the protesters' demands that the department be defunded and that the station be turned into a community center. One Seattle police officer candidly saying the department has made mistakes.
We want a dialogue. We want to communicate, right? But if the public is so angry at us, how do we start that? How do we do better? People expect better. We need to be better.
As for when the standoff might end, the mayor hasn't indicated, saying the city could have what she calls the summer of love, prompting another fiery tweet from the president. These liberal Dems don't have a clue. The terrorists burn and pillage our cities, and they think it is just wonderful, even the death. Must end this Seattle takeover now.
The occupation will last indefinitely, but I do see them getting back into their building. They're going to get back into their building to get their stuff out. I don't see them getting back in after that.
Well, city leaders acknowledge that everything has been peaceful and you continue to have this street festival-like situation, but there appears to be no strategy in place in terms of how or when officers will seek to reclaim that station.
Seattle has become largely a matter of perspective. Is this a largely peaceful takeover of part of the city? Can you have a peaceful takeover? Or do you have an occupation? Now we hear that the protesters are negotiating with officials. Should they have the leverage to negotiate in a city where they are not supposed to have any control? There's a map of this new so-called area. They're calling it CHAZ, the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone. It takes up several city blocks. People were pushed out. Police were pushed out of the area on Monday. There's a live look. If you look at it, it's not an angry protest. It's not really organized, but it is completely occupied. I interviewed Seattle's mayor yesterday. She made a reference to the 1967 Summer of Love. She got some love for that and some critics, including the president, saying this is anarchy and officials need to shut it down. Mayor Jenny Durkin returns tonight. Ms. Mayor, thank you very much for taking the opportunity. What can you tell us about the state of play?
Chris, thanks for having me back. First, I want to assure the president that Seattle is fine. I'm not sure what he's so afraid of, and what he's depicting to the nation just isn't true. I spent time in the area today talking to people, listening to their concerns, talking about what brought them there, what they want to see for our city and for community. I don't know why the president is so afraid of democracy. Free speech is part of who we are. It's how we started as a nation. We will be fine in Seattle. We don't need the president's help.
So the president is saying, yes, of course, there's hyperbole in there. It's like a hellscape out of Mad Max. This is the, the left run amok, all that. And yet you do have a reality on your hands. You have negotiations between the people who are there and police. They seem to feel that they have a sense of domain where they are. They are in control of that area so that you can't have normal traffic. You don't have normal life there. You have your police chief saying she didn't want to leave the precinct, that the city caved to pressure. That doesn't sound great either, does it?
So place-based protests are nothing new in Seattle or across America. I mean, you saw Occupy take part of Wall Street for almost 8 months in New York, and the city managed to survive. Mm-hmm. I think what we really have to do is, you know, it's the old saying of we're given, you know, one mouth but two ears. It's time to listen. What's happening in America right now is so significant. And we as leaders have to listen and determine what changes can we bring to bring us to a better country and better cities. My job as mayor is to move forward in a way that really pays attention to the very legitimate pain and rage in the streets about centuries of systemic racism and communities being held back. If we miss this opportunity, our nation will miss an opportunity. And so I'm not afraid to listen to people. I'm not afraid to hear what they want and to see if we as a city can address that very real pain.
Negotiations. What are the state of negotiations? What are they asking for? What do you like? What do you not like?
So I've met with many community groups over the last 2 weeks. There's a range of demands and desires by people, which everything from how we do policing, that we've met some of them already, to how do we really do the thing people want the most, and that is invest in community, invest in their children, invest in opportunity, and making sure that our schools, our healthcare systems, our equity, an economy are built for everybody. Because if you look across all of our systems, people of color, and particularly Black Americans, have been left behind in every one of them. That doesn't happen by mistake. It happens because of how the structures are built. And so when I listen to people, mostly what I hear is their desire to see the true opportunity and equity be made real in all of those systems, that we as a society invest in those systems greater than we've already invested in the criminal justice system. And I think that's the right path forward.
I actually think the linking thought to what's going to bring about a new culture wave of change will be that, yes, of course, color and systemic racism is a reality, but that the need and the spread of opportunity is more have-not than it is just color. Color, absolutely. Race is an identifiable and an intrinsic part of inequality in this society. But it goes beyond that. And I think if you can get that out of these streets, that it's color and, you know, race and that there is a list of needs for society, I think you have the best chance at seeing changes from power. One last thing, Mayor, while I have you. The idea of what you'll give on and what you won't, the idea of removing police from the community, of making that building something else, will the police return there to work, or is that building going to become something else?
Police have been back in there. The chief of police was there yesterday. They've had some people in there. And we're going to continue to analyze whether that's the best place for the police to operate, whether there's additional things. But really what I hear from people when I listen to them is, first, I've got to listen. And the harder it is for me to listen, the more important it is that I be sitting and listening. And the second is, you know, I think Dave Chappelle said it very well. This movement came from the streets. It didn't come from politicians. It didn't come from elected leaders. And we've got to, some ways, get out of the way and to listen to the streets, because those kind of movements are what has moved America forward through its whole existence. Yeah. And I think we've got to do that. And if we miss this opportunity, I would say shame on all of us.
Yeah, look, there's no question. We've never had any meaningful change that hasn't started at the grassroots, the street, the people, the populist level. I think that's always been true. And we'll see where it goes here. You certainly have a lot of people watching, Mayor Durkin, and you will continue to have this platform to explain the situation.
Thanks very much, Chris. Take care.